Welcome to ATCM, the Emergency Medicine Channel. Today we are discussing about PR interval in ECG. You may be knowing that P wave is originated from the atrium or SA node, and it takes some time to reach the AV node. The time period between the origination of P wave to reaching the AV node is PR interval. The PR interval is the onset of P wave to the onset of QRS. Normal PR interval is 120 to 200 milliseconds or 3 to 5 small squares in ECG. So the normal PR interval is 3 to 5 small squares. P wave originates from the atria or SA node. It reaches the ventricle or AV node. The time taken from that onset to reaching the AV node is PR interval. The conduction time is PR interval. So PR interval normal is 3 to 5 small squares. Now we will talk about which condition is going to prolong the PR interval. So normally PR interval is 3 to 5 small squares. If the PR interval is more than 5 small squares, you can call it as a first degree heart block. There is a problem in the conduction. Normal PR interval is 0.12 to 0.2 seconds, that is 3 to 5 small squares. If the PR interval, the onset of P2, the QRS complex is more than 5 small squares, you can call it as a first degree heart block. So first degree heart block, you can see this ECG, PR interval is prolonged. It is almost nearly 7 to 8 small squares. So PR interval is prolonged. We can call it as first degree heart block. This ECG again shows there is a first degree heart block. PR interval is nearly 8 to 10 small squares. PR interval is prolonged. You can make a diagnosis of first degree heart block. See, we'll see what are the causes for first degree heart block. So any intrinsic AV node disease, there is a old age or ischemia, all these things can produce prolongation of PR interval. Enhanced vagal tones can sometimes produce prolonged PR interval. Ischemic heart disease, especially acute MI, mainly inferior wall MI, can produce all type of blocks. First degree heart block is also common. Myocarditis, especially viral myocarditis, rheumatic fever, carditis, all these things can present with prolonged PR interval. First degree heart block is possible. Hypokalemia, hypomagnesemia, both can produce prolonged PR interval. Drugs like beta blockers, some calcium channel blockers, digoxin, all those things can produce increase the refractory time of AV node, that can produce first degree heart block. What the simple example I'll tell you, a young patient come with joint pains, and after a few days he develops a first degree heart block. Fever, joint pains, carditis is a classical feature of rheumatic heart disease. Like that, you have to think any disease which can involve the heart, infections or ischemic condition, can produce first degree heart block. So first degree heart block is the prolongation of the PR interval. There are a lot of drugs can produce first degree heart block, in that quinidine, procainamide, beta blockers, flecainide, amiodarone, sotalol, calcium channel blockers like diltiazem, verapamil, digoxin, magnesium, all these things can produce prolongation of the PR interval and first degree heart block. Now we'll see what are the conditions which can produce shortening of the PR interval. Normally PR interval is, we have already learned, 3 to 5 small squares. If it is less than, PR interval is less than 3 small squares, we have to suspect there is some accessory pathway. Through the accessory pathway, the current has passed very fast and reached the AV node. From SA node to AV node, there is an accessory pathway which takes the current and it travels faster than the original pathway. You get a short PR interval. One of the condition where you get short PR interval is Wolff-Parkinson-White syndrome or WP-W syndrome. There you have an accessory pathway from SA node to AV node. The current passes very fast. You can see this ECG, you have short PR interval and slurring of the QRS complex, upslope of the QRS complex, that is called as delta wave, and you get a wide QRS complex. That is classical of WPW syndrome. There is an accessory pathway. So in WPWP syndrome, there is an accessory pathway which conducts the electrical activity from the atria to ventricle. This accessory pathway is called as bundle of Kent. This produces very fast conduction of the heartbeat from SI node to AV node, electrical current. Sometimes it can lead to supraventricular tachycardias. You can see in this ECG, there are two types of WPAW syndrome. One is type A and another one is type B. Whether in type 1A or type B, you can see the short PR interval. You get a slurring of the QRS complex that is called as delta wave. So there are two types of WPAW syndrome, type A and type B. Both the condition PR interval is short. So one of the commonest condition where you get short PR interval is WPAW syndrome. Now, complication of WPAW syndrome, we have to think, one of the most important complication is supraventricular tachycardia. Any time a patient who is having WPAW syndrome can develop severe tachyarrhythmia. So, supraventricular tachycardias are common. Because of this paroxysmal supraventricular tachycardia, patient can have syncope. Sometimes, rarely, patient can have death also. So, supraventricular tachycardia is the most common condition, complication of WPAW syndrome. There is another condition called as Long-Ganong-Levin syndrome. It is also an accessory pathway. The accessory pathway in LGL syndrome connect distally to the normal conduction pathway to the bundle of His. So, it is a distal connection. In the WPAW syndrome, the accessory pathway, connects to the ventricle myocardium. It's actually connected to the ventricular myocardium, but LGL syndrome, it connects to the distal pathway of the bundle of His. So in LGL syndrome, you will see short PR interval, but you don't see a delta wave, you don't see a wide QRS complex. This is LGL syndrome. Now, we'll see what happens to the PR segment, what are the abnormalities of PR segment. In normal ECG reading, PR segment does not have any major clinical importance, but we take PR segment as an isoelectrical line. So, it is neither positive nor negative, it is an isoelectrical line. Always ST segment should fall on the same line of the PR segment. That is the importance of normal ECG reading. So, after P wave, there is a segment which is called as PR segment, that is taken as a isoelectrical line. Now, we will see what are the condition, rare condition which can produce PR segment depression. Pericarditis is the common condition which can produce a PR segment depression. We'll see what are the findings seen in pericarditis. Pericarditis, you get PR segment depression, widespread ST elevation, that is a concave ST elevation upward, and reciprocal ST depression and PR elevation in AVR and V1. Absence of reciprocal ST segment in other leads. Like normally in MI, you get anterior wall MI, inferior wall, you get reciprocal changes. But in pericarditis, you get a widespread ST elevation and PR segment depression. Whatever it is, PR segment depression is a classically seen in pericarditis. PR segment depression classically seen in pericarditis. Now, PR segment elevation also seen in pericarditis. PR segment depression in V5 is due to acute pericarditis, and the same ECG shows PR segment elevation in AVR is due to acute pericarditis. So, in AVR, if you are seeing a PR segment elevation, you have to think about pericarditis. Now, atrial ischemia or atrial MI, it can be associated with PR segment elevation, not very common. PR segment elevation is very rarely seen in atrial ischemia or infarction, but this shows a very, very poor outcome in a patient who is having MI. So, elevation of PR segment is may be seen in atrial MI, but PR segment depression or elevation both can be observed in pericarditis. So, we have discussed about PR segment. A PR segment should be taken as an isoelectric line. That is the same ST segment should fall on the same segment. If the PR segment is elevated, we can suspect pericarditis or atrial MI. If PR segment is depressed, we have to think about pericarditis. Thank you.